Hello everyone. In this lecture, let's learn about the concept of file system and about the different types of file access methods. So first is, we all know that secondary memory is used to store large amounts of data. The amount of data in the secondary memory is in terms of millions of bits of data or billions of bits of data. So, and computer systems generally use this secondary storage devices like hard drives or magnetic disks or magnetic tapes are used as the primary online storage medium for information. So we are going to store large amounts of data in secondary memory, and so we need a mechanism for organizing the data. So if we don't have a mechanism for organizing the data, then searching or retrieving the data from the secondary memory becomes next to impossible. So for that purpose, we have the concept of file system. So file system is a concept which provides a mechanism for organization of the data which is stored in the secondary storage devices like a hard drive or a disk drive, etc. It also provides mechanisms for retrieving the files from the disk. Okay, so if you don't have a file system, then the files on the disks will not have a proper organization, and retrieving of the files from the disk will also be not possible. It will be very difficult. Without the concept of file system, we can't even have two files with the same names. So file system is the one which helps us to organize the files on the disk as well as to retrieve or search for the files on the disk. Another important thing is the different files in the file system are also grouped into categories called as directories. In Windows, we will call this as folders. So files may be categorized into directories for ease of use. And what is the role of the operating system here? We know that file is a logical storage unit. Whenever a user creates a file on a system, that is nothing but a logical storage unit. And the data which is stored or represented in the form of files is actually going to be stored on the physical devices which reside on the physical devices, which we call it as secondary memory. So this mapping between the logical storage unit of files is mapped onto the actual storage devices by the operating system. So that is the role of the operating system here. The OS is responsible for mapping the logical files onto the real physical devices, which we call it as secondary storage devices. And the most common file systems are, which we use in real time, are the FAT file allocation table, which was used in the older versions of Windows, and then the NTFS file system, which is almost used in many versions of Windows, like Windows 7, 8, 10, Windows XP, Windows Vista, as well as it's also being used in Linux and BSD range of operating systems. And then another common file system is the global file system, which is a shared disk file system which is being supported by Linux computer clusters. So these are all some common examples of file systems used by operating systems. So next, coming into our file concept, what is the meaning of a file? So a file is nothing but, logical concept. It's a logical storage unit, which is actually realized with the help of the physical properties of the storage devices present with the computer system. File is nothing but a logical unit, and the data stored in the file is realized or actually implemented with the help of the storage which you get from the storage devices, with the help of the space available in the storage devices. So the operating system abstracts the physical properties of the storage devices to define a logical storage unit called the file. And another definition is, file can be called as a named collection of related information, which is defined by the file owner, as well as it is being recorded on the secondary storage devices. So files can represent any type of data. It can store programs. It can store any type of data. The data can be numeric data or alphanumeric data. It can store graphics, it can store sound recordings, it can store text, it can store numeric data, etc. So every file on the file system has a certain structure, but all files don't follow the same structure. The structure of a file depends on the type of the file. So if you take a text file, the text file will be a sequence of characters which may be organized one line after the other. If you take a source program file, it may contain some header files, header file declarations. It may contain some declarations of variables. Then it will be followed by some executable statements. It may also contain some sequences of function codes, etc. So that is the structure for your source file. If it is an object file, we'll be having a sequence of bytes. bytes may be collected together to form blocks in such a way that it is understood by the program which is going to use it. So here for our object file, the program which is going to use the object file is your linker. So object file will be in a format which can be understood by the linker. If you take an executable file, exe file, it will be a series of code sections which, so that it is possible for the loader to bring it into memory and execute. So every file has a certain structure which is dependent on the type of the file. So next is about the file attributes. So attributes, yeah. Okay, so the attributes of the file, here we know that to identify the file, we'll have an attribute called as file name. So all other attributes of the file may vary from one operating system to another. Some of the common file attributes are listed here. So first attribute is the name of the file. We know that it is used to uniquely identify the file. And most commonly, when we name the file, we give the name for the file followed by a dot followed by the type of the file. This is used by the user to identify the file type. But no operating systems don't enforce that file type has to be mentioned by the user. So first attribute is name. Name is the only information which is kept in human readable form. And this is used to identify the file. Second is the identifier. Now this identifier will be a unique number which is used to identify the file within the file system. But this identifier will not be in human readable form. It is in non-human readable form. The third one is the file type. So if your system supports multiple different file types, then you have to mention the file type there. Fourth one is the file location. Now this is used to find the location of the file on the disk. Fifth one is the size. Size is used to represent what is the current size of the file. It might be represented in bytes or words or blocks, or it may also contain information about what is the maximum allowed size for this particular file type. Next attribute is file protection. This file protection attribute contains access control information about which process is allowed to do the reading, read, write, execute operations on the file. Next operation is the time, date, and user identification attribute. So this information is here. This attribute contains information about when the file was created, when it was last modified, when it was last used, etc. So the OS uses this information for protection and security purposes. Okay, so apart from this, another important thing is you have something called as a directory structure. This is specifically used to contain information about all the files maintained on the disk. What information is maintained on the directory structure is, it is used to contain the file name and the file identifier. I told the first two, file name and the file identifier. Name will be in human readable form, identifier will not be in human readable form. Both these two are maintained by the directory entry. And apart from this, it may contain a pointer which points to the actual location of the file on the disk. And one more important thing is this directory structure will also reside on the disk only. So sometimes what happens is, if your file system stores too many number of files, it may take more than 1 kilobyte to record this information for each file. For each file, the information about the file may take up to 1 kilobyte of space. So this shows the file information window on Mac OS operating system. You can see that it stores information about the type of the file, size of the file in bytes, how much size on the disk, the location of the file, when the file was created, at what time the file was created, at what time the file was modified. All such informations are maintained in this file information window. Here you can see the file access permissions also. Who has what type of access? Who doesn't have access? Everything is being available. So next is about the file operations. So file is just an abstract data type. So if you want to make use of the concept of file and to define the file properly, we need to define the operations which can be performed on the files. So there are 6 different types of operations which can be performed on the file, and the OS provides various system calls to implement these operations. For example, for open, you have the open system call. For read, you have the read system call. For write, you have the write system call, etc. So first one is the creation of the file. So to create a file, first space has to be available found in the file system for the file, and then an entry has to be created for the for that file in the directory. Okay, so once this is done, a file is created and then an entry for the file is made in the directory. The second file operation is writing a file. So to write to a file, the user will make use of the write system call, specifying the name of the file and what information has to be written to the file. And then the system will search the directory to find the file's location. And then a write pointer is being maintained, which will point to the location where the next write has to take place. And after the write operation is completed, the write pointer will be updated. So this is how write operation takes place. Third one is reading a file. Again, for reading the file, we use a read system call where we have to specify the name of the file and where that block of the file has to be. If you are reading the contents of the file to the memory, so where it has to be put into memory, that information can also be mentioned. So again, the directory entry will be searched for the corresponding file, and the system will make use of a read pointer, which will contain the location where the next read has to take place. In case read is taking place record by record, then read pointer will be updated after every read operation. The fourth operation is repositioning a file. Here, no input output is actually carried out. Simply, the file pointer will be repositioned. The file pointer location will be changed to the location which is specified in the system call. Fifth one is deleting a file. So to delete a file, first of all, the OS has to search the directory for that particular file, and then once the file entry is found in the directory, then all the space which is memory which has been allocated to the file, all the space which is allocated to the file on the disk, everything has to be released, and then the entry for that file in the directory also will be deleted. The last file operation is truncating a file. So if you want to maintain the file and its attributes, but you don't want to maintain the contents of the file, then you will make use of the truncation operation. So here the file will be reset to length zero. All the space allocated to the file will be released, but the file will be existing with its attributes. So that is about the different types of file operations. So there are six different types of file operations, namely file creation, file deletion, reading, writing, repositioning and truncating a file. So next is about the implementation of the open and the close operations. When your system supports multiple processes to share the files, then the implementation of open and close operation requires some data structures. Because every time whenever a process wants to open a file, searching the directory entry will be a very tedious task. So in order to avoid frequent searching of the directory entry, OS maintains a small data structure called as the open file table. Now this open file table contains information about all the open files in the system. So whenever a file has to be searched, whenever a file operation has been requested, then the file, through the index of this open file table, the file will be searched for, so that it will not be, there's no requirement for you to search in the directory entry for the file. Whenever a file is closed by the process, and if the file is no longer used, that entry for the file will be removed from the open file table. Two more data structures which has been used by the operating system is per process table and the system wide table. Now this per process table tracks a list of all the files which has been opened by a process. Each per process table contains a pointer to the system wide table. And this system wide table, what it will do is whenever a file is opened by a process, an entry for the file is made in the open file table. Remember that open file table is the one which I told you previously. An entry for the file is made in the open file table, which in turn will point to an entry in the system-wide table. If later, let's say another process opens the file, then another new entry will be made in the open file table, but it will again point to the same entry in the system-wide table. So in this way, system-wide table can keep track of what are all the processes which are working on any particular file. So it maintains information about all the files in the system. So all the files which are open in the system, they will have the following four information associated with them. So this piece of information will be maintained for all the open files. First one is file pointer. File pointer is used for finding the next read location or the next write location. Whenever a read or write operation is performed, the file pointer is updated to point to the next record or to the next location inside the file where the next read or write operation has to take place. Next is file open count. It keeps a list of all the processes which has opened the file. So when file open count becomes zero, it means no process is currently using the file, and so the entry for the file will be removed from the open file table. Third one is disk location of the file. So this specifies the location of the file on the disk. This is useful if you want to bring the file from the disk to memory, then it facilitates easier retrieval. Fourth one is access rights. So every process is allowed to open a file in a particular access mode. So this access rights information contains what type of access rights protection that particular process has, so that if the process tries to use that file in some other mode, then the operating system can allow or deny it based on the access rights for that particular file for the process. So some operating systems also provide facilities for file locking. Whenever a file is opened, then the process can get some locks called as shared locks or exclusive locks. Shared locks are nothing but previously we learned about reader-writer problem. So similar to that, if multiple processes want to read a file simultaneously, they can get a shared lock. If some process wants to write to a file, then it can get an exclusive lock and write to the file. So this facility is provided by some types of operating systems. So that's all about the different types of file operations. We saw that there are six types of file operations. The next is about the different types of file types. So every file is specified or saved with a file name followed by dot followed by an extension, and that extension usually specifies the type of the file. These are some commonly used file types. First is executable files. File types can be categorized into these categories. So executable files are ready to run files. They can be, we know that we can load an executable file into memory to get the output for our code. So they usually have these extensions, namely .exe, .bin, .com, etc. The second type of file is object files. They usually have the extension .obj or .o. This means that these type of files will contain machine language code, or also called as object code, but they will not be linked. Third type of files is the source code files. These are nothing but the files which are written in some particular programming language. For example, your C code might have the extension .c, your Java file might have the extension .java, your Pascal program may contain the extension .pas, your assembler program may contain the extension .asm, your library file may contain the extension .a, etc. Similarly, command interpreter programs will have the extension .bat or .sh. They are called batch files. Text files may have the extension like .txt, .doc. Word processor files may have the extension like .wp, .tx, .rtf, etc. Library files may have the extension like .lib, .a, .so, .dll, etc. So here .a stands for archived library files, and .so stands for shared object files. So the difference between these two is .a, archived library files, makes use of static linking, and .so, shared object files, makes use of dynamic linking. And then printing or viewing file types is, you have .ps, which stands for PostScript, .pdf and .jpg. So here .ps, PostScript files are commonly used printing file formats, which are used in the publishing industry. You also have many archive files. Commonly we would have encountered these type of files. We use this .zip or .tar files for compressing the files and sending them over the network, etc. And then we have a large range of multimedia file types. Some of them are listed here: .mpeg, .mov, .mp3, .mp4, and then we have .flv files, .avi files, .rm. .rm stands for real media. So this is used for streaming the content over the internet. So these are some common examples of file types. Okay, and their extensions. Next is about file structure. A file can have three types of structures, and operating systems, most of the operating systems support only minimal number of file structures. Why they support only minimal number of file structures is, if an operating system supports more number of file structures, let's say if an OS supports five types of file structures, then it has to incorporate the code for supporting all these file structures. And in that way, the size of the operating system becomes large. So in order to avoid that, most of the operating system supports only minimal number of file structures. For example, in Unix or MS-DOS operating system, the file is supposed to be a sequence of 8-bit bytes. No other interpretation of the bits is made by the operating system. So there are three types of file structures. One is it may not have any definite structure. So in that case, that OS will consider the file as a sequence of words or a sequence of bytes or something like that. The other one is simple record structure. We can define a file to be some fixed number of lines of some fixed length or varying length. Third one is complex structure. Complex structure means that if your file is a formatted document which has to follow a fixed format, or if it is a reloadable load files, all these types of files will come under complex structures. So that is all about the different types of file structures. With this, the concept of file concept is over. The next is about the different types of file access methods. So we all know that files store a lot of information. OS stores information in ranges of millions or billions of bits of information. So there should be some way for the OS to access this information and read it into the computer's memory. So for that, there are two types of access methods commonly used. One is sequential access method and the other one is direct access method. So some operating systems provide support for only one type of access method. Some OS provide support for more than one access method. In that case, it is the responsibility of the application to choose which access method to use. So first type of access method is called as sequential access method. As the name implies, here the information in the file will be stored sequentially, and it will be accessed or processed in sequential order. Sequential order means one record after the other. For example, editors or compilers makes use of this sequential access method. You can always, so if you want to access record number 15, you have to start from record number 1, move to 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, and so on, and then get record number 15. So here, there are two types of operations. Read operation is given by read next and write operation is given by write next, where you will be having the file pointer. So file pointer, whichever position the file pointer is pointing to, read operation will read that particular record and then advances the file pointer to the next record. Similarly, for the write operation will check the position of the write pointer. It will write the contents of the file, new information, and then finally it will advance the write pointer to the end of the newly written file. But one thing to remember is always the read pointer or the write pointer is moved ahead one by one record after another. So this is a diagram which shows the concept of sequential access. You can see that the rewinding is also possible, where a program may be able to skip backward for some n integers. And it also shows the beginning and the end of the file. So this resembles a tape model of a file, where the records of the file can be accessed in order, one after the other. One record after the other only can be accessed. Second type of access is called as direct access. So here in direct access, we assume that file is made up of fixed length logical records, but then the records can be accessed randomly in any order. So there is no particular order which you have to follow to read or write the record. But then they can be accessed randomly in any order. So direct access is also called as relative access. And we can say that it resembles a disk model of a file, because if you imagine the disk model, any record can be randomly accessed from any location. So that is this direct access or relative access. So here, this is being followed by databases. We saw that sequential access is used by compilers or editors, but direct access is used by databases. Suppose a query arrives to the operating system, then what the database will do is it will compute the particular block where that particular information is available, and directly it will try to access the information in that block. Okay, so this is useful when you have to access large amounts of information, because you don't have a restriction that you have to follow or access the records one after the other. So if you want to simulate sequential access on direct access, we know that sequential access is ordered access, direct access is random access. So if you want to do this ordered access on the random access, the implementation may look like this. So reset to the beginning of the file can be done by setting the current pointer to zero. Read next operation can be implemented like this. We can read the current position of the current pointer, and then current after doing the reading operation, value of the current pointer can be incremented by one. Write next can be implemented like this. We can write to the right. We can first get the current position of the current pointer, write the contents of the file, and then the value of the current pointer will be incremented by one. So file operations in direct access method will look like read n and write n. We just saw that in sequential access, it was read next and write next. We will be able to only sequentially access one record after the other. But here, we have to randomly access any particular block number. So the user has to specify the block number also. So here, commands will look like this, read n and write n, where n stands for your block number. But the block number which is mentioned by the user is only a relative block number. It is not the actual block number. Why the relative block numbers are provided by the user is, it helps the operating system to prevent the user from accessing accessing those portions of the file system which the user is not allowed to access. So this relative block number given by the user, there will be an index relative to the beginning of the file. For example, if the user may specify a relative block number like 0, which might be actually in some disk address like 14,544, etc. So this mapping of the relative block number with the actual disk address will be done by the operating system. So you also have other type of access methods apart from sequential and direct access, and that is called indexed access method. So in index access method, index is like the index of your book. The index will contain pointers to the various blocks. Okay, let's say for example you have a retail price file, and this retail price file maintains the product codes of various items as well as their prices. So this index may contain the first it may contain the product code of the first record for that particular for that particular block. So in case sometimes if the if the file system contains too much of files, then the index file also may be too large. In that case, we can split the index file into two, master index and secondary index. And master index might be residing in the memory, and the secondary index may be residing in the secondary storage device, and it may actually point to the actual file blocks. Okay, so this implementation in real time, IBM makes use of indexed sequential access method, and VMS operating system makes use of indexed relative file access method. So what is indexed sequential access method? We know that sequential access means ordered access. Index means we are maintaining some index, which is going to be a pointer, which is we are going to construct an index for the file with the help of this index. So, and it is going to contain pointers to the various blocks or the various records contained in your actual files. So IBM makes use of this method, and VMS operating system uses index with relative access. Relative access means we know that it allows for random access to all those records on the random disk blocks. Index is going to contain a pointer pointing to those actual disk blocks. So index with relative access in VMS operating system looks like this. So here you can see an index file. Here you can see the actual file residing on the secondary memory, which actually contains the last name, first name, social security number, and the age of the employee. And the index file contains the last names of all the employees. Actually, it contains the last name. Actually, it contains pointer to the first record of each disk block. Okay, so here you have the pointer where the first record's last name is Smith, and this pointer points to the actual disk block or to the location of the actual disk block in the secondary memory. So in this way, index file is helpful for us to make the search operation quicker. So whenever you want to search a larger file, instead of searching through the entire file for that particular record, index is like the index of a book, which will actually contain pointer to the actual block containing your desired record. So that is all about index and relative file access.